Calcium channel blockers are one group of medications that are commonly known as CCBs. They can be classified into two categories, dihydropyridines and non-dihydropyridines. Even though these two categories of drugs are blocking calcium channels, but they are not equivalent chemically as well as pharmacologically. They differ in their selectivity of their target and how they are going to produce their side effects and what are the uses of this medication. Normally, calcium channels can be classified into different categories. Among these, voltage-gated calcium channels can be classified into five types based on their role and function in the body. They can be classified as L-type, N-type, P-by-Q-type, T-type, and R-type. Now, CCBs are blocking L-type calcium channels. These L-type calcium channels are the long-acting voltage-gated calcium channels which are responsible for entry of calcium into the target muscle. L-type calcium channels are present on smooth muscle, including vascular smooth muscle. They also present on the heart. These L-type calcium channels are voltage gated, that means they are opened and closed based on the membrane potential. This is the smooth muscle which is expressed with L-type calcium channels. When the smooth muscle is depolarized, it can open the L-type calcium channels, resulting in the entry of calcium into the muscle. The increased intracellular calcium levels can produce a contraction of the muscle. Even though the contractile mechanism is somewhat different in smooth muscle as well as in the heart, but the role of calcium is same, it can produce a contraction of both smooth muscle as well as heart through L-type calcium channels. Now, dihydropyridines are one group of calcium channel blockers which are selective for smooth muscles, including vascular smooth muscle. These drugs can be identified very easily with their suffix dipine. Dipine indicates they are dihydropyridines. So we have so many drugs in this category like nifedipine, amlodipine, nicardipine, nimodipine, felodipine, isradipine, clavidipine, and nisoldipine. All these drugs are the dihydropyridines having the suffix dipine. These drugs are highly selective for smooth muscle and they particularly act on the vascular smooth muscle as vasodilators. On the other hand, non-dihydropyridines are selective for the heart with little selectivity on smooth muscle. Verapamil and Diltiazem are the two important non-dihydropyridines. Verapamil is a phenyl alkylamine, whereas Diltiazem is a benzothiazepine. So both are not related to dihydropyridines. However, their selectivity is somewhat different. Verapamil is more selective towards the heart, whereas Diltiazem can act on both heart as well as smooth muscle. In a simple way, dihydropyridines are selective for vascular smooth muscle, verapamil is selective for the cardiac muscle, whereas Diltiazem can act on both of these muscles. Because of their difference in their selectivity, these drugs differ in their clinical uses as well as in the side effects. So in this video, let us explore such differences between calcium channel blockers. First of all, let us see the clinical use of these CCBs. The main role of calcium channel blockers is to reduce the contraction of either smooth muscle or cardiac muscle. However, dihydropyridines are more selective towards the smooth muscle. Therefore, they can reduce the contraction of vascular smooth muscle, resulting in vasodilation. That's why dihydropyridines mainly show their effect on blood vessels, resulting in that reduced blood pressure, and they are mainly indicated for the treatment of hypertension. Even though dihydropyridines are not directly acting on the heart, but still they can be used for the treatment of angina. Angina is a pain in the heart due to insufficient blood supply to the cardiac muscle. Even though dihydropyridines are not acting on the cardiac muscle directly, but they can act on the blood vessels supplying to the cardiac system. They can improve the blood supply to the cardiac muscle by producing vasodilation. That's why dihydropyridines are particularly useful in the treatment of vasospastic angina, an angina associated with vasoconstriction. However, dihydropyridines can also be used to manage chronic stable angina and Prinzmetal's metal angina. Among the dihydropyridines, nimodipine is one of the medication which produces vasodilation of cerebral blood vessels. That's why this medication can be used in the treatment of cerebral vasospasm. Another use of dihydropyridine is in the treatment of Raynaud's disease. It is one of the peripheral artery disease which is associated with vasoconstriction at the extremities like hands and feet. Since dihydropyridines act as vasodilators, they can improve the blood supply and they can reduce the symptoms of Raynaud's disease. However, this is not an approved indication of dihydropyridines. They are used as an off-label purpose for the treatment of Raynaud's disease. Similarly, another clinical use is in the treatment of migraine headache. Dihydropyridines can produce vasodilation, but they can reduce the cranial vasodilation. So this reduces the migraine headache when they are used at lower doses. However, at higher doses, dihydropyridines can further increase the migraine headache by increasing the cranial vasodilation. So these are the various clinical use of dihydropyridines. They are mainly used for the treatment of hypertension and angina. On the other hand, non-dihydropyridines can have different clinical indications. Verapamil is one of the non-dihydropyridine which is selective for the heart and it can reduce the contraction of the heart. It can also reduce the transmission of impulses through the SA node as well as AV node. Therefore, verapamil can suppress the activity of the heart and it can be used in the treatment of atrial fibrillation as well as atrial flutter. It can also be used for another condition, paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia, commonly known as PSVT. It is a condition of sudden induction of tachycardia due to the impulses coming above the ventricles. Since verapamil can reduce the AV nodal conduction, it can reduce the paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia. Another use of non-dihydropyridines is in the treatment of angina. Since they are directly acting on the heart, they can reduce the rate of contraction as well as they reduce the cardiac work. Since the cardiac work is reduced, utilization of oxygen by cardiac cells reduces, which results in the relief of symptoms in angina. At this clinical use, both dihydropyridines as well as non-dihydropyridines can be used for the treatment of angina. Similarly, verapamil can also be used for the management of blood pressure. Since it reduces the cardiac contraction, it also reduces the blood pressure. So they can also be used for the management of hypertension. Particularly, diltiazem is somewhat selective towards the vascular smooth muscle and it is having the more effect on reducing blood pressure. So dihydropyridines are not suitable for cardiac arrhythmias, whereas non-dihydropyridines can be used for the treatment of cardiac arrhythmias. Similarly, let us see the difference in their side effects. Dihydropyridines are having the more selectivity towards the vascular smooth muscle. Therefore, they produce few of the side effects that are related with vasodilation. One of the important side effects is the peripheral edema, where these drugs can produce ankle swelling as well as leg edema. They can also produce another side effect called flushing, which is the vasodilatory response on the face, resulting in the redness of the face. Because of vasodilation, dihydropyridines can also produce dizziness, headache, and hypotension. Apart from these common side effects, dihydropyridines may have another side effect because of reflex action. Dihydropyridines are going to reduce the blood pressure directly, blocking the calcium channels on the vascular smooth muscle. This results in the increased activation of sympathetic system in the brain, which increases the release of sympathetic mediators that more act on the heart, resulting in the reflex action. So this results in the increased rate of contraction of the heart, leading to tachycardia and palpitations. This tachycardia is called as reflex tachycardia. Here we can clearly observe that non-dihydropyridines are reducing the cardiac contraction, whereas dihydropyridines are going to increase the cardiac contraction because of reflex action. And few of the dihydropyridines like amlodipine can produce another condition, gingival hyperplasia, a proliferation of gums can be observed. Now let us see the side effects of non-dihydropyridines. One of the important side effects of non-dihydropyridines is the constipation. Particularly, verapamil produces constipation by blocking the calcium in the GI smooth muscle. As calcium is not available, GI smooth muscle cannot contract, resulting in the decreased GI motility. This results in the constipation in the people. Another effect of verapamil is on the heart. It reduces the rate of contraction of the heart, resulting in the bradycardia. Dihydropyridines produce tachycardia, whereas non-dihydropyridines produce bradycardia. And they can also reduce the calcium entry in the other smooth muscles, resulting in the fatigue, weakness and tiredness in the people. And it can also produce some difficulty breathing, dizziness and headache in the people. As non-dihydropyridines can also reduce the blood pressure, They can also produce hypotension as another important side effect. So these are the various side effects of non-dihydropyridines. Dihydropyridines mainly produce peripheral edema as well as reflex tachycardia, whereas non-dihydropyridines mainly produce constipation and bradycardia. So these are the various types of calcium channel blockers and how they differ in their clinical uses and side effects. I hope this video is useful to you. If you really like this video, please subscribe our channel and hit the like button. Please post your comments and opinions in the comment section. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video.